get out of bed, get changed out of your PJs, grab a coffee, because we have another at-home edition of World of Fortnite for you. I'm your host, Sarah Pookieface Lynn, and with me, as always, but still virtually, is Shia Wager.
On today's show, we have controversial changes to Fortnite in the rotation, one of it just shows us how Fortnite uses the map to tell its story, and of course, we have everything the community is passing around in the low ground.
But first, let's talk about Epic and how they've targeted Street Fighter fans with its next crossover. Ryu and Chun-Li are the next two characters to come through the zero point. Shio, how do you feel about this?
For me, big fan of both Street Fighter 5 and Street Fighter 4. I'm a little bit more on the Mortal Kombat side of things as well, so I'm liking, you know, games being introduced in other games. Hoping that we get even more of it and get more IPs into Fortnite.
I'd love myself a good crossover as well, but up next, the rotation runs down 5 controversial changes Epic has made to Fortnite.
Creating a good game with a healthy player base is difficult. Rarely do we get a game where the developers manage to create something that is loved by millions from all over the world. But when someone does manage to do that, the next step is just as hard, if not harder, and that is satisfying a player base of millions. 3 years after Fortnite's release, with several other Battle Royale games releasing in between, the game is still right there at the top. Naturally, with a game so popular, it is hard to take decisions with the direction of the game without upsetting at least some of the player base. Today, we'll be taking you through 5 of the most controversial changes Epic has made to Fortnite. At number 5, we have the traps being vaulted. Traps have been through plenty of changes since the beginning of Fortnite. Epic kept nerfing or buffing them, and then either hit too hard or barely do any damage at all. In any case, they've always been a core part of the Fortnite loot pool. It was a surprise when they got entirely vaulted in the beginning of 2020, and we never really got an explanation. The most accepted theory is that people got too good at building and peace control, and boxing people in and placing traps might be too powerful in the current meta and on the new map. After all, they used to do 150 damage, and the new map introduced plenty of new portals via phone booths and dumpsters. At number 4, we have the turbo building nerf from Season X. Turbo building is one of the most revolutionary changes Epic has introduced into the game. Holding down your building button and being able to place structures without releasing it changed the game forever. A year later, when the skill ceiling was too high, Epic tried to nerf it. In a Season X update, they added a very short delay after placing consecutive structures, something that was a direct nerf to the 90s that people had gotten used to. The community reacted like Epic had removed building from the game entirely, stolen their V-Bucks, and the developers were physically doing Take the L in their living rooms. Needless to say, Epic undid the nerf quickly, and the world was okay again, except that now the other half of the player base could continue to vent about how broken building really was. Number 3 on our list is the release of the Battle Royale mode itself. Fortnite was originally released as a co-op survival game, which we now know as Save the World. Epic decided to expand the possibilities of Fortnite by adding in the Battle Royale mode in September 2017. When Fortnite Battle Royale started spiking up in popularity just a month after its release, the creators of PUBG, another Battle Royale game, sued it for copyright infringement. Nothing came out of that, but they weren't the only ones who didn't like the new PvP mode. A lot of people simply hated Fortnite for jumping on the Battle Royale hype train. Moreover, a lot of the original Fortnite players were also pretty upset, because the success of Battle Royale began what would be the end of Save the World mode forever. Number 2 on our list is the official conclusion to Save the World. The crazy success of the Battle Royale mode led to Save the World being put on the back burner, and the latter's updates got pretty repetitive over the next few years. In 2020, Epic scrapped their plans of making Save the World free to play, declared that content updates would be slow and infrequent, and that the story of the game mode was officially over. I can't say how bad the outrage was in this case, because nobody visits the Save the World subreddit to begin with, so Epic probably doesn't even know if there was an outrage. That reminds me, do you think we'll get a Schrodinger's cat skin or something? At number 1, above the release and end of entire game modes and core mechanics being nerfed, we have the mechs from Season X. The Fortnite community as a whole has never been as unhappy as it has been during Season X. The mechs were a two-player vehicle, where one player would control its movement while the other controlled its extremely overpowered missiles. The vehicle was so bad that it made some of the game's most popular and successful streamers rage quit Fortnite until they were vaulted. This clip of Tim the Tap Man wiping out a squad using the mech with his monitor turned off shows just how bad it really was. Hopefully, we never get something this broken ever again.
I think changes happen in every game that kind of just make us ask the question, why? Shia, what Fortnite change bothered you the most?
For me, anytime they ever touch building, I get a little bit itchy, so to speak, and it's an itch I can't scratch, so it kind of bothers me. I just like it when, you know, the core mechanics of the game are left untouched or just improved over time instead of, you know, getting a little bit de-evolved or devalued. For you though, Pookie, what are your opinions on, you know, the addition of Battle Royale to the game? Do you think Fortnite had all this planned from the get-go?
Well, I can tell you for a fact that they absolutely did not have it planned. So they were working on Save the World for years prior to the BR getting released. And I was actually at Epic HQ and got a little bit of a preview of what they were working on before they actually released BR. There was, you know, 10 guys working on it. It was in their spare time. They weren't really treating it too seriously. And when I saw it, I kind of knew that it was going to blow up. I didn't think it was going to get this big. I'm not a prophet or anything, but I definitely saw the value that it could hold. And it was a great decision. It was an amazing, amazing play for them. And it definitely worked out for them in the long run. But let's get things rolling because I called up the Kelly Link to talk all things Fortnite. Today, I have the chance to sit down with Kelly Link, esports host extraordinaire. Kelly, thank you so much for sitting down and talking all things Fortnite with me today.
Pooks, thank you for having me on the show. I'm glad to be here.
Thanks so much. So first off, let's start off with something basic for our viewers. I know a lot of people are curious. How did you get into esports? What drew you to the scene? What was that whole journey like for you?
Oh gosh. Okay, so like hardcore esports, going to like tournaments, doing interviews was back in like 2009. I think I went to, or maybe it was 2010, that I went to the first CEO that was in Florida. Which is a fighting game tournament. And then in 2011, I went to MLG Orlando for the StarCraft II competition that they had. But it actually starts like way before then. When I was 15 years old, I was the president of the anime club for my high school. And I also really liked Smash Brothers. So I would run local high school tournaments for the rest of my classmates. And I think that's really like what kicked it all off.
Yeah, that's amazing. So you've been around the block a time or two. You've been here for quite some time. You've seen a lot of games in their inception and ones that are obviously a lot more developed. You did a lot of work in multiple scenes. But what were your first impressions of Fortnite when you saw it? What were your first thoughts?
Oh, gosh. Okay, so I played Fortnite way back when, before it even had a battle royale mode. It was just this like zombie wave clear, which I think is still in the game, but you have to like go to a different section of it. And I, to be candid, was not very impressed. So in my mind, I already had this thought of like, all right, I don't like Fortnite, I'm not gonna play it. And then like half a year later, they released the battle royale mode and I didn't really give it a chance. I was playing H1Z1, PUBG, in my mind, I already had a battle royale. And then I got to host the DreamHack open back in July. And the amount of effort that a Fortnite player has to have as far as like in a competitive level, whether it's regards to rotations, knowing their drop spots, and building. I have a whole new appreciation for the competitive level of Fortnite now that I've been able to work on it, because I think a lot of people tend to think of it as being sort of the more like youth-focused battle royale out there. But it's insane the level of mechanics and game sense that has to go into like being a top player.
Yeah, I could not agree with you more. Definitely, myself included, huge appreciation for all the pro players out there. It's crazy. The amount of things you have to be thinking about constantly, it's absolutely unreal. Just recently though, you were on the analyst desk for FNCS. You're working with Zeke and Shio. Can you walk me through what that was like for you?
Oh man, well first of all, super like nerve-wracking. I mean, you've been in the industry for a long time. Being a host is a very different set of skills than being a caster or an analyst or an interviewer even. And so when I was presented with this opportunity after hosting for DreamHack for so long, it's never even something that I've done. I've never been an analyst for games that I even worked for the company for years. So it seemed like a new opportunity. It definitely was a little bit daunting, but I feel like part of esports, especially like as a host and maybe partially as an analyst, is telling the story of the players, where they started, how they're doing now, whether that's positive or negative. And so I feel like there is definitely some translation there. But again, I have a whole new appreciation for analysts and how much they actually know and are able to break down the game, because it is something that has been quite a journey for me so far.
Well, you did an absolutely incredible job, so congratulations. I was watching.
Thank you.
And I have to say, you absolutely killed it. I have to pick your brain, though. What was one standout moment for you during the NA West broadcast? Were there any players whose performances surprised you or jumped out at you?
100%. Oh my gosh. Okay, so the reigning champs from season 4, Rex, Epic, Whale, and Arkrim, don't qualify out of round three for week one, which is the top 33 teams. That's still, like, you know, it's a pretty short pool of teams, and there's a lot of incredible teams out there. But to have the reigning champs not even make it into there was completely unheard of. And then week two, which just happened, they like blow through the entire competition. They get first place out of round 4. They beat everyone else by like 60 points compared to second place. So to just see this team, who you expected to be amazing, not even make it into like the finals of round 4, and then to absolutely dominate, is kind of like a perfect example of what North American West competition is.
Thank you so, so much for taking the time to speak with me today. Such a pleasure. And as always, Kelly, I will see you on the Battle Bus.
Fugi, thank you so much. It's been an absolute pleasure.
Vas-y.
Vous êtes prêts? Go.
Ouais.
Attendez. Là,
le dernier. 30, 60 crack.
Contact à nous.
24 blancs, net. Vas-y, go push les autres. Ils vont avant qu'ils fuient. Il y en a un qui monte tout en haut, je le fight. Vas-y, fais. Tu me dis quand ça tombe. Crack. Dead. Contact. Un HP. GG, va tous.
Don't kill him. Right, we'll take turns. Just trying to hit the trigger.
Alright, get it!
Hey!
How far in did you go? Oh my god, where are you? There's gonna be a sneaky little person up here then.
Gotta say, Hot Drops never fails to impress, but sometimes we just need to bring it down to a little bit of a lower level, bring it down a notch, and it's time for low ground. So Lachlan says that he found a new game-breaking glitch with the zero point. I have to to say, this has to be one of my favorite memes that I've seen in a really long time. It has dad joke written all over it, and I'm here for it. So take notes, kids. Fortnite can save you a trip to the grocery store.
I'm wondering if those bananas get more expensive or you pay less for them. But either way, next up, the casual Dunme keeps the meme going with the Mandalorian. All right, now I really want like the superpower to be able to, you know, super hydraulic beam transport between video games and universes. But I promise you guys, that is the last time we'll show off that meme in today's low ground.
I mean, moving on from there, even if we can move on from there, Joel96FL buys 4 exotic.
There he is. Boy, do I have some business for you, my friends. Oh, this fight, there is 5 of them. Should I buy more than one? Why not? I just spent a lot of my gold. This might have been a mistake. All right.
If you do something and then immediately afterwards have to say, this might have been a mistake, I think you already know that it was a mistake.
Unless a mistake you were making was actually not a mistake, but then you said it was a mistake, and then the mistake was actually not a mistake. It might be a mistake, but moving on past all of that, next up is New Putty, who shows us how it's done with 5 exotic shotguns. Due to an issue, I'm not sure how I feel about this. It's obviously not intended, but it's also really cool.
I mean, some call it cool, some call it game-breaking. I mean, it's really up to you. But finally, official Zach J puts Chun-Li's taunts to work. Shio, just back away slowly. Don't make any sudden movements.
Yo, what if I want to? What if I want to get in the business and take a fight with Chun-Li? What if I just want to lose, right? Because that's probably what's going to end up happening. But anyways, let's move on to more winning moments and find out how Fortnite uses its map to tell its story in Point of Interest.
Fortnite's uniqueness goes beyond its building mechanics. The game has also been telling a long and slightly complicated story over the last few years, and it's really commendable how they've managed to tie it all together with both skins and map updates. Aside from cutscenes, Fortnite's map is the real narrator of the story. Things happen to characters that are immediately reflected through map changes, and the Fortnite map has changed so much through the years. Today, we'll be taking you through Fortnite's most prominent changes and how the game has told the story of its characters through these map changes. Fortnite's map was pretty simple and empty when the game came out. At this point, we didn't know if the game had a story. It was a battle royale with building mechanics, and that's about all we knew about it. Fortnite's first big map update was pretty well received, although it had nothing to do with the story at all. However, we got a few iconic locations, such as Tilted Towers, that would later play a big role in the main storyline. The story started when a certain meteor in the sky came crashing onto the island in Season 4, and created a massive crater in the middle of the map, destroying Dusty Depot and replacing it with Dusty Divot. This was the first time Fortnite's story played a role in the alteration of the map. At the end of the season, Tilted Towers was almost destroyed by the visitor's rocket launch. Season 5 brought in map changes via its Rift theme, where a bunch of random objects were transported around through space and time. This was Fortnite's way of introducing interdimensional travel to the game. The cube introduced in Season 5 also affected the map. While it rolled around the map, barely doing anything in that season, Season 6 brought in the floating Loot Lake house, changing the lake forever. Loot Lake was later transformed into Leaky Lake through the end of the season update, where we met the Rift Butterfly for the first time. Season 7 happened in December and brought with it the Ice King, who did his little dance move and covered the entire map in snow. The Ice King was there to obtain the power of the Zero Point, and also brought with him a monster that was hidden at Polar Peaks. Season 8 gave us the volcano and jungle biome up north. The same volcano erupted at the end of the season, dropping a big lava bomb onto Tilted Towers like it was playing pocket tanks. One of the most popular locations was finally destroyed. Season 9 had a futuristic theme. To escape the wrath of the volcano, Jonesy and Peely slipped into a bunker to protect themselves. When a lot of time had passed and Jonesy came out, he saw a futuristic version of Tilted Towers called Neo Tilted. We also got a new mode of transport in this season, Slipstreams. The end event of Season 9 had a battle between Ice King's monster and the giant robot. The robot killed the monster with a sword and left its skeleton in the middle of the map, creating a new point of interest for Season X. Season X had the most iconic map change of all. In an epic finale, Fortnite's first chapter ended when a black hole was created at the center of the map, engulfing it and taking us into a new world. Chapter 2's first map change was the creation of the Agency, the headquarters and the control point of the organization in power. The Agency, also known as the Authority, witnessed several interesting events, such as Fortnite Mares 2020 and the battle for control between Ghost and Shadow. During the device event, Midas messed the map up big time by trying to control the Zero Point. This led to most of the map being flooded, giving us an interesting new water-themed season and a new location called the Fortilla. In the next season, we got the Avengers arriving on the island to protect us from Galactus. To better equip us for the battle, Tony Stark used the rifts to teleport the entire Stark Industries to Fortnite. This took Fatal Fields away from us, replacing it with Tony Stark's headquarters. The latest major map update was in Season 5, when the Zero Point grew unstable and brought in old locations such as Tilted Towers back to the map. The center of the map is now a desert area, and plenty of old POIs are scattered around. The map is sure to keep changing in the future, and as the season comes to an end, we possibly have some of the biggest map changes to look forward to. Since we've both been playing Fortnite since the beginning, Shia, I need to pick your brain on something. I need to know what the most jarring map change was for you.
For me, this might have been a little bit before maybe a lot of the viewers have been playing Fortnite, but it was something called The Block added to the game, I think around Season 6, Season 7-ish. It was kind of like a thing that if you had like a creative map made, they put it into Battle Royale, it would change every single week. It was a lot of fun to adapt to, kind of jarring, but my favorite POI, and I miss it a lot.
Yeah, I couldn't agree with you more, but that about does it for us. But for more of our content, check out our YouTube and Twitter channels at WatchWOF.
Thank you so much for watching. And as per usual, as per every week, here is your usual order of a Victory Royale with some cheese.